God. Hi, everybody.
Hi, everyone.
Oh, Bob, I have a present for you.
Oh.
Open it now.
Wow.
It is
a very rare Don't Tell a Soul notebook.
That's right.
Thank you.
One of a kind. I got it in Indianapolis.
When?
A couple weeks ago.
Oh, nice. Good to see they're being bootlegged.
That's right. That's right. Oh, well, thank you for coming, everybody. Bob, thank you for having me. I'm honored to be here. I know there are a lot of people in the book who are out there, who make appearances in the book.
I see a few. I'm looking for a few others. But yeah, well, I'll in due time, I will probably shout out a few people. So.
Yes. Now, I wanted to, if you don't mind, for anybody who's here who may not be that familiar with The Replacements, I would love for you to read. This is one of, this might be my favorite passage in the book.
I'll give it a shot. So
okay.
I think this is probably, to give you an idea, maybe just in a sort of thumbnail sketch of what day-to-day life with The Replacements was like, particularly by the time they got to the major labels. This is the period in 86, I believe the summer of 86, when they're interviewing producers for their second major label album that would become Pleased to Meet Me. They had been interviewing producers after a fashion at a restaurant and drinking and alienating people, and then they sort of moved the party over to Sire's offices, where Michael Hill, who's there, was dealing with them, and so begins this brief interlude. The band locked themselves into Sire's conference room. With several producers scheduled to visit, Hill would slip records by the prospective candidates under the door for the band to listen to. The mats would break the LPs and slip the shattered pieces back to him. Inside, the band rummaged through several storage closets and found a stack of red credit card carbons and began smearing the ink on their faces and the walls. Soon they were blasting songs and rattling around Seymour Stein's vintage Wurlitzer jukebox. A horrified Stein began yelling at Hill, "My jukebox, this is your fault! Get them out of here now!" "Oh God, it was so embarrassing," recalled Hill. "I was never a hugely prideful person about that stuff, so I didn't take it personally, but it was exasperating. Guys, please don't fuck with me like this." The band paused in time to meet with Scott Litt, a former power station engineer who'd produced the DBs and had gone top 10 the previous summer with Katrina and the Waves Walking on Sunshine. As Litt walked into the room, the band, their faces inked up to look like tribal war paint, gang-tackled him onto the floor. "It was like Lord of the Flies in the conference room," recalled Litt. "I was kind of ready for it since their reputation preceded them. But what am I going to say to them looking like that? Hey, I have a new way of making a record with you?" The Replacements weren't interested in meeting with a young up-and-comer like Litt and turned him down. A few months later, he began working on REM's breakthrough Document. By the end of that long, fraught day, even the typically restrained Hill ran out of patience. After they came out, I closed my door and said, "I'm locking myself in my office and I'm not coming out. I've had it." Part of our behavior was an act, said Westerberg. But when Bob was gone, we were scared. It was just the three of us, and we were trying to do every kind of weird, wild thing to distract ourselves from that. They would piss everyone off, noted manager Russ Rieger, but there was a lot of respect for them as artists. If they were an ordinary band, they would have been dropped. But it was the brilliance of Paul's writing and the humanity that would come out of him, and the magic of the group that would keep everyone believing, even when you wanted to kill them.
Excellent. Yes.
Wrong thing.
Now, when I was 19 years old, I grew up near Philadelphia, and I left home to move to Winston-Salem, North Carolina, to join a rock band called The Right Profile. You've never heard of us. But our managers were Russ and Gary. High Noon.
Gary's right there.
Who I've not seen in 25 years, I think. And guys, I want to take this moment. Well, before you leave, if I ever groused about what I perceived as the lack of attention you guys were giving me, I had no idea what you guys were up against until I read this book. I knew it was tough, but this is some sheer insanity in this.
I think, you know, Russ and Gary started managing the band basically just as the first major label record, Tim, was completed, and they jumped onto a moving train, and they did a heck of a job trying to figure out, especially in that first year, basically they were parting with Peter Jesperson, they were parting with Bob Stinson, and I can't imagine a situation where two managers could walk into that was more chaotic. I mean, just starting with the replacements in general. So that was part of the book, was realizing what a tough job these guys had, and Michael Hill had, you know, the whole time.
Now, let's talk about your first exposure to the band. When did you first
I was just a kid watching Saturday Night Live. This would have been January of 86. I was 11 or so. And, you know, at that time, there wasn't a whole lot, of, at least in my memory, live music on television like that, rock and roll. I mean, the most music I probably saw was like Solid Gold or something, people in leotards dancing. And so here comes this band, so loud and so loose. And looking back on it now, I mean, even now, I think it's one of the best performances on Saturday Night Live, certainly the first song, Bastards of Young. And so they sort of just jumped out at me and captured and perhaps corrupted my young mind. And it was another year or so before I found Pleased to Meet Me. And sort of that was the start of a relationship with the Replacements that began, you know, casually and became more intense as time went on.
Right. And I'm sure you've told the story a million times, but the first, not step, the first, one of the first steps in the road to the book was when you interviewed Paul around the time of Folker.
Yeah, I interviewed Paul in 2004, and you know, I'd interviewed him a few times on the phone and had met him or had just interviewed him on the phone, and so this was an assignment to go out and meet him first face to face. And he was in an interesting point in his life. His father had just passed and his own kid was growing up, and I found somebody at that point who was much different than the Paul Westerberg of legend or reputation. He was really thoughtful and really reflective and actually maybe even remorseful about some of the things when it came to the Replacements. So I thought, well, you know, maybe there's a point I can start, you know, here, that this book wouldn't be impossible, because I'd always assumed he'd be too flippant or too cavalier or dismissive or trying to protect himself in a way. But he was, we started at that point, and it was, you know, it took several more years for the book to get started. Originally, I pitched the book to him as a Replacements book, and he came back and said, well, forget the Replacements, let's just you and me write my memoir. So I decided I didn't want to do that for several reasons. One, because I didn't think he would actually follow through on it, and that really wasn't the story I wanted to tell. So I kind of worked, I was, you know, building a relationship with him. And so then I went to Tommy, I had dinner with Tommy Stinson, and I pitched the book to him, and he agreed and said smirkingly, okay, I'll do it if Paul will, thinking Paul will never do it, and that's Tommy's way of getting out of most things, I think, having to do the Replacements. But eventually, a few months later, I was in Minneapolis doing a story for Spin and interviewing Paul at his home, and, you know, we talked and did the interview, and he turned the recorder off, and he said, okay, let's talk about the book. And sitting there, I think at this point he hadn't had his back surgery, so a lot of these interviews and encounters with him are with him either laying on his back or, you know, so it was a very kind of Freudian psychological thing going on already. And he probably understood, certainly more than I did, and maybe more than most people, what this book, the end result, was probably going to be like. Because he said to me that day, he said, if you do this and you do this book right, it's not going to be very flattering, particularly to me, but there's really no point doing it unless you're going to sort of tell the truth. So I think he knew, you know, 6 years, 7 years before the book came out, what it was probably going to entail. Because he knew I was going to do the work, and, you know, he knew what he had done.
And what has been his reaction to it?
Well, he, as with most things, he claims he doesn't read his press, but then, of course, when you sort of mention something, he can, like, quote his press back to you chapter and verse. So there's that. But he wasn't going to read the book, and then at sort of the 11th hour after the galleys were printed and the book was literally about to go to press, this was around Christmas, just this last Christmas, he said, I got a call from his current manager and said, oh, you know, he wants to read the book. Originally, he was going to write like a funny blurb, but then he thought, oh, I'll write a serious blurb. So I really, you know, you've put 7 years work into this. Why don't I actually read the thing? So I thought, okay. And so I sent him the book, FedExed him the book, and he got it at 9 a.m. At 3 a.m., my phone started ringing. unknown caller, and I knew which
you had to know something.
Yeah, I didn't. Once I realized it wasn't my parents or family emergency, and it was an unknown number, I knew pretty quickly who it was and what it was going to be. So he left a sort of garbled message, as you might expect from him at 3 a.m. And I called him back the next morning. Let's just say my sleep that night wasn't great.
I can't imagine.
But we talked the next day, and he is such a bright guy, and he's a reader of history and biography and all these things. He sort of was able to pinpoint the things that I thought I did well and the things I didn't do well, and he asked about narrative choices and things like that. And there was a few things that he was bugged about, and I sort of wrestled with him. I said, listen, because my deal with them had always been that they would participate, but that it was going to be, you know, an unauthorized, essentially, biography. They wouldn't have any editorial control.
Right.
So, you know, we had a long talk. I remember I was standing outside in my shorts having this talk that might have, you know, I thought he might sic his lawyer on me. Who knows if he hates it that much. At the end, I sort of warmed down. He got bored. He said, I got to go have some dinner. And that was it. And since then, all the feedback has been positive. I think, you know, it's the book, some of these things, the stories, some of this knowledge has sort of existed among fans,
sure,
among people who knew. But to see it, I think what his initial reaction, the 3 a.m. call, was to just seeing his life put down across 500 pages. I mean, I'm sure that would be a mind warp for anybody, particularly if, you know, somebody had taken such forensic detail to
right.
your 20s, which I wouldn't want, but, you know, so.
Well, speaking of forensic detail, Bob knows that I have read pretty much every rock bio or autobiography that's ever been written.
Certainly about Kiss, you have.
Yes, well, sure. Well, of course, but this is the most thoroughly researched of any of them I've ever come across. It's just insane.
Well, that can be good or bad.
Oh, it's great.
It was about 1,000 pages in its original
yes.
manuscript. I had to cut some of the detail down and change some of the names to protect the guilty. But
I was wondering if when Paul was reading it, or when Tommy and the other guys were reading it, if they were just mind blown by the fact that you found this completely sidebar guy that I'm sure they'd forgotten about.
Yeah, I mean, their memories, both Paul and Tommy's memories are interesting. But Tommy, so he doesn't remember some of the early stuff because he was such a young kid.
Right.
With Paul, he remembers some of the early stuff, you know, pre-replacements very well, and then, you know, or he'll remember specific things about episodes or moments in the studio with such clarity, and then he'll say things like, let it be, was that before or after Tim?
Right.
You know, so, you know, I'm sure there's some, he was in a bit of a fugue state or at some point, and so, you know, these things kind of blur, as I'm
right.
sure you know as a musician,
sure.
but I was surprised. Yeah, I think they were sort of blown away, like, I found the guy who ran the halfway house that they were kicked out of as the Impediments,
right.
who said, you'll never work again, and thus they changed their name to the Replacements. And he died, actually, not long after I talked to him. It had nothing to do with me. But, you know, he sort of didn't remember them specifically, but he did remember the incident. And so Tommy was like, what? How did you... You know, so, I mean, yeah, I mean, I did a lot of... I did spend... It was a book I thought would take 2 years, and it took 7, so maybe some of that time was spent wisely, and maybe some of it was spent chasing down a guy who kicked him out 37 years ago.
It's worth it. It's worth it. One thing that I know I came with away with, Bob would send me chapters as he was writing it, just to get like a fresh set of eyes on it, and he sent them also to Tommy Keene, our friend. And
so if there's anything you don't like, it's John's
fault. It's my fault. But I just remember like going, just constantly going, oh my God, like I can't believe, like I knew just from being around the High Noon office sometimes, like there was craziness going on, but I couldn't really get my head around a lot of it.
Well, you know, one of the things that I wanted to do with the book was try and understand that, because there's a difference between just recounting the stories and the anecdotes and the kind of bad behavior and trying to understand what was behind it, or if there was anything behind it. And I think in their case, there was and there wasn't. I mean, some of it was just, so much of their behavior was born out of fear and suspicion,
right.
Particularly once they got to the major label world. But also, And this ties into why there's kind of sketches of people like Russ and Gary and Michael that are a little bit more explored. I explored the people who work with them, because the Replacements were not, by conventional definition, a self-determining group. They basically would do things to drive most people away, whether it was producers or A&R people or prospective managers, and whoever kind of stayed behind, whoever ran that gauntlet, whoever passed this sort of hazing ritual, was who they would work with. So it became really paramount importance to understand the kind of people who were working with them, because they had a lot more impact and say in how the Replacements' career unfolded than maybe with some other bands who were more self-determining, say like REM, who of course had a good manager, but you know what I mean?
Right.
The Replacements' way of conducting their career was to create chaos and react to people's reactions to that, essentially.
Right.
So,
you mentioned REM, and I love that in the book. A constant thread in here is the parallel trajectories of the two bands' careers, and they could not have played it more differently, each band. And I was wondering if you wanted to talk about that a little.
Well, that was interesting to me. I mean, for a lot of reasons. I mean, the sort of hidden kind of rivalry. I mean, there was always this perceived rivalry, but it was actually much more of a real one, dating back to when Peter Jespersen sort of left the Replacements for a time to go road manage REM, and that really stuck in Paul and Tommy's craw, because they were not people who trusted easily. And so that was kind of the first thing. And then, of course, REM begins to succeed. I mean, there was a certain point where the Replacements signed to Tim, and they were maybe a little bit ahead in terms of coolness and perception,
right.
And REM had a dip with their record that came out in 85. And then, of course, the Replacements are about to make their third record for Warner Brothers, which is supposed to be their breakthrough, and who signs to Warner Brothers but REM off a million-selling album. So REM kind of became the bar, in a sense, when they had that platinum success. And there was a lot of differences. I mean, I talked to Peter Buck about that, and what was interesting to me is Buck said that there was a point around 85 where, you know, they're still on IRS, and he was saying, you know, we didn't have any promo budget really, and the last record hadn't done as well as they had hoped, and he was thinking like, well, do we stop doing this? Do we break up the band? Do we just do this as like weekenders and
right.
kind of, you know, tamp down, you know? And they had an actual meeting about that. They articulated whether they were going to make that move and what they were going to do and what the lines were for them in their careers. The Replacements never had that meeting, certainly amongst themselves. Maybe Paul had it with Russ, or Paul had it with, or Tommy had it with Gary, but they never communicated to themselves what they were willing to do, what they wanted to do, and what the goal was. And a lot of that is Paul. It was down to Paul kind of leading by example, and Tommy and everybody following his lead. And if Paul was uncertain about something or ambivalent about something, it would tend to sort of go that way for the rest of the
right.
group.
What were your takeaways in terms of each guy, of Chris, Paul, Tommy, Bob, Slim?
Well, the book really, in a sense, is the story of, at least the first part of it, the story of the Stinson family and the horrible things that happened to Bob in particular, and how that sort of guided his, you know, he basically was a subject of sexual and physical abuse. He came back to Minnesota after years away and got stuck in the state juvenile system for many years. And it was there that he reconnected with the world by playing guitar and having this desire to form a band. Comes back, sees Tommy going down a kind of criminal path, hooks up with him, says, you're going to play the bass. So they have this kind of desperation that Paul, who comes from a less sort of tragic environment, but one that's still, you know, filled with a lot of alcoholism, a lot of depression, a lot of cynicism about the business world and success, they hook up. And, you know, I think Paul in 77, he quit high school and became a janitor for the most part for a couple years, but he really was saying, I'm going to be a musician. I mean, he could have got his degree, and he said, I'm going to quit. This is how I'm casting my lot. I'm going to do this come hell or high water. And at that point, he wasn't even a songwriter. But what he was searching for those years between 77 and 79 was someone, as he puts it, who had the same sense of desperation that he did, and he found it in the Stinson brothers and Chris Mars. And so for me, that's kind of the starting point, is this desperation, and where does that come from? For Bob, it was the kind of this, you know, physical and sexual abuse and the demons of his youth. For Tommy, it was sort of being untouched by that, but growing up in the shadow of that. For Chris, he had his own things. He was an artistic temperament he had a brother who was a severe schizophrenic, and that had sort of colored his childhood and the fear that it might happen to him. And Paul was, I don't know, I mean, Paul is Paul. I mean, his father was a guy who, you know, you talk about the band not communicating. Paul was a guy whose father walked through, you know, D-Day plus two, and his job was to pull the rings off the corpses of the bodies, and he never talked about that experience right. to Paul. So you talk about sort of Midwestern stoicism, and he's a guy who, you know, sold insurance for cars for a living, and every night he would come home and tell Paul, you know, insurance is the biggest scam in the world, you know? So you see where some of these things have been imbued into Paul and maybe why they weren't kind of most likely to succeed once they got to the right. to the major label world. Yeah. So that was my kind of takeaway, was built on their childhoods and their formative years, because the more I researched, I realized how central that was to the story. And in a way, I don't think anybody really around them realized the depth of all that stuff. If they had, you know, certainly they would have done things differently. I know Russ and Gary tried, you know, when things got really bad with Paul's drinking towards the end of the band, there was attempts made to say, like, what do we do? This guy is harming himself. But, you know, Paul made himself an island, right. And he was an island even within the band to a certain extent, with maybe, you know, moments with Tommy. So, you know, it was just, for me, the takeaway was trying to understand who these guys were before they ever formed the Replacements, and how that upbringing impacted everything that would come after.
Right, right. There's an ongoing thing in the book that it's funny, but it's also very sad, and it's just the career suicide that just yeah. is constantly going on. And there's a great quote of yours in an interview where it's basically you just said each guy was ill-suited for success,
yeah.
which I think is true.
Well, and there's also a bit of Minnesota in that. I mean, Tommy says it in the book. He didn't realize at the time that Paul was a guy, a lot of Paul's drinking and certainly some of his behavior as a result of that was self-medicating. You know, he had depression issues, which he dealt with later in life. But, you know, Tommy was a young guy, and he was sort of taking his cues from Paul, I think, in terms of how to behave to a certain extent. I think later that changed. But, you know, Paul was a guy who... He was less afraid of failing than he was of trying and being judged, mm-hmm. Which is to say that he never really put his best foot forward in terms of doing the things that you needed to do. And that may have in some ways extended to crafting the songs in a way that would have been more commercial. I know Russ certainly tried to get him to do that at times, to follow on those instincts, because Paul wanted a radio hit. He was a guy who grew up on bubblegum music and pop music, but there was something in his nature that wouldn't sort of allow him to, I guess, what he perceived, compromise himself. Or you know, I theorize, and in talking to him, he sort of theorized that he does have a little bit of, I guess, what they call oppositional defiant syndrome, yeah. where it's yeah. sort of, you know, it's a clinical condition of you say left, he goes right. And so I think that was part of it, too, when I say they were ill-suited, yeah. you know.
And there are so many examples in it in the book of just, you know, like the CBGB show. I think was that 1984 where they're playing
right.
for essentially trying to get a record deal, and it could not have gone worse.
Well, and that episode of How the Replacements Got Signed is kind of a perfect example. So they were on the cover of the Village Voice. R.J. Smith wrote this story, which at the time was an incredibly huge deal for a band at the Replacements level. They have a secret show where they're billed as Gary and the Boners at CBGB's late night show. Certainly a big contingent of the New York A&R community is coming out to sign them. And they just basically, you know, play what we perceive as a classic drunken covers replacement set and run everybody out of the building, including Gene Simmons, who as soon as he came in, they found out he was there and they started playing Black Diamond, and Gene Simmons came scurrying out. And I don't know if George Regis is here, but he was standing at the entrance as all these A&R guys are just sort of leaving and patting him on the back saying, sorry, kid, you know. But, of course, three nights later or whatever it was, they play Irving Plaza, maybe their best show or one of their best shows ever in New York, and they happen to be seen by Seymour Stein, who immediately falls in love and signs them. And Michael becomes the A&R man. Michael Hill had been trying to sign them without success, trying to convince Warner Brothers proper to sign them, and Seymour sort of swooped in. So that sort of, that dichotomy, the paradox of, you know, when everything seemed to be on the line, they blow it, and when there was no stakes, seemingly, or relatively no stakes, that's when they played their best. And it still, and it kind of worked out for them. You know, I think Sire was the best place for them in a way, certainly at that time. So,
speaking of Seymour Stein, there's a great quote in the book where he says, "Their charisma pardoned their sins."
Yeah, and it's interesting. For Seymour, it was about their charisma pardoned their sins. When I talked to Lenny Warnker, he was saying, well, a hit would have pardoned a lot more.
Right, right.
So, you know, that's maybe the difference between Seymour and Lenny to some extent. But yeah, I mean, that is the really kind of the story. When we talk about the Replacements, we're not talking about a band that crashed and burned in 2 years.
No, no.
They went on for 12 years and made 8 albums, 4 major label albums, and probably could have done more as the Replacements if they wanted to. So there had to be something that kept people going and kept people believing. And it was that every third show, or it was that transcendent song that Paul would write, or it was when they chose to, on the rare occasions, when they chose to be really charming and ingratiating, as I think they were during the playback party for Pleased to Meet Me in Memphis.
Right.
You know, they created a lot of chaos there, but they made everybody at the label feel like they were part of the chaos. And, you know, that was one of Russ and Gary's great coups, getting, you know, a bunch of people from across the company and Warner Brothers International to come to Memphis in 1987 for a Replacements playback. You know, you might have done that for Fleetwood Mac or Madonna or somebody, but... And in that instance, the Replacements did great, and they were, you know, walked away, I think, everybody wanting to work that record, and some other things happened with the ledge that sort of torpedoed it. But, you know... In their moments, they could be, they were charming, and they made everybody feel like they were part of the party, and maybe some people sort of encouraged that behavior on their part because they liked to be part of that too, you know?
Right. One thing, as a musician at the time, I remember, you know, they're my favorite band. But I also remember being very, very frustrated with them. And that frustration came back as I read the part about the Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers tour. It's like we were a band, we got signed, and we just didn't have the momentum that they had, or the, you know, they were a way better band than us too, but we would have killed to have gotten the Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers tour.
Right.
And they got one, and it was like the moment they realized they were going to be playing to 100 or so people finding their seats every night.
Yeah.
It was out of the, yeah, well, it was thrown. Not thrown, but.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of the Petty Tour is a really interesting thing, and I think it comprises one of the longer chapters, but that was the thing of, you know, this is 1989, this is pre-Nirvana, pre-alternative radio being a real commercial force, and the Replacements were sort of between, they weren't a classic rock band, they weren't, you know, a dance or pop band, obviously, so, you know, how do you take a band like that to a bigger marketplace or expose them to more people? And so, you know, it had worked to a certain extent for the Del Fuegos and the Georgia Satellites on the previous Petty Tour. That was, I think, a pretty successful thing, certainly for the Satellites, who ended up having a hit in that summer in 87. But I think the thinking was right. You know, it's like, sure, Tom Petty fans will be into the Replacements, right, or if they put their best foot forward, they'll be in there. But the interesting thing about the Replacements is, you know, from the first 3-4 gigs they played were disasters. They got kicked out of a couple of them. Once they hooked up with Peter Jesperson, who was kind of a mover and shaker in Minneapolis, and signed them to Twin Tone, and basically became part of a group of people who took care of them. And again, you know, none of these guys could drive, so just getting to the gigs in those early years was a challenge. I don't know how they would have done it. Everything was on an upward trajectory from basically May of 1980.
Right.
And they were building and growing, and every record was, you know, responded to more favorably. Any time, and this is goes to say how delicate and sort of sensitive they were as people, any time there was a little bit of a setback, it totally kind of destroyed them in a small way. It happened, I think, the first time when they went to Europe in 86. Outside of London, nobody really cared about the band. And immediately, they hated London, or hated Europe, and hated England. You know, as Paul said, won't say what Paul said, but, you know, so they kind of, you know, and they got a late start in Europe, and then they didn't go back as much as probably should have, but, you know, that was one instance where when people weren't falling on their knees in worship, that they were like, oh, I don't like this feeling at all.
Yes.
And so when they went on the Petty Tour, that was just magnified everything, I think, because, you know, they started out trying to play it straight, and there were nights where they played it straight and really tried to go for it, and I think the first shows were in arenas in Florida and stuff. And when they didn't get any response, which was almost worse than being booed off, that really started to sink them on a lot of levels. You know, Paul said there were some nights they would be playing at these sheds in August, and there would be like 300-400 people spread out in a 12,000-15,000 seat amphitheater. And, you know, they could see the faces of these petty fans buying their T-shirts and sitting there sort of bored. So, of course, they had to mess with them. And as Paul said, you know, we weren't having fun on that 1 hour on stage, so we were going to have fun the other 23 hours of the day. So that went on. And also, you know, when they did play well on occasion to petty audiences, which at that point were very mainstream in the wake of Free Fallin' and Full Moon Fever, they weren't getting anything. And that was death to Paul Westerberg, you know, getting no response when you played well. And as he put it, or getting a sort of lukewarm response, he put it, you know, it's one thing to get rejected by a small club audience of a couple hundred people, but when you get rejected by 20,000 people, that's like a small city, you know. So, and then I think he saw in Petty the kind of professionalism and the repetition that was required to succeed at that level. And repetition to them, again, was kind of death, you know. They would make fun of Petty and his moves because he would do the same move in the same part of the song every night. And so then, of course, they started messing with Petty and messing with his crew. And generally, the headliner doesn't like that.
No. You'll love it when he does it. Is
yeah,
that what
that's, yeah, he would say, you know, Paul was at one point, I don't know if it was in Pine Knob or somewhere, he was like doing all these weird sort of rock star moves. And he's like, you'll love it when Petty does it, you know. So, But the truth of that, the bigger truth of all that is, too, the band at that point was 10 years old and had probably run its course, certainly from Paul's perspective. And again, it was another thing of that record having tremendous expectations and feeling like they were almost going to get there, and then it fell short again. And I think, you know, Paul had to sort of be talked into making the next record, which he, as a band record, which he sort of did, and he sort of didn't. But yeah, I mean, a lot of bands would have taken that opportunity and maybe run with it or had a good time, but at that moment it was kind of the wrong thing for the Replacements, but it may have never been the right moment for them.
Right. I do wonder what would have happened had they really gone for it. I think they could have been one of the biggest bands in the world.
You know, that's a question that comes up a lot in this, and I feel sort of bad talking about it like we talk about, oh, the commercial failure, or this record peaked at 51, or this, that. In a way, the beauty of doing this book and seeing them reunite and seeing them play to, you know, 12,000 people at Forest Hills who all know the songs and who are all singing it back to them and who are multiple generations, they won in the end. You know, they didn't have that radio hit in 1985 or 87 or 89, but they have something that I think is much more valuable, and it's going to last a lot longer. And maybe some of that, I won't say all of it because I think a good percentage of it is built on the songs, but maybe some of that or a good bit of it is built on the fact that they did fall short. That's why they stayed sort of romantic, they stayed sort of frozen as these kind of, you know, the idea of the beautiful loser, the band that just fell short. And some of that is, you know, they are also credited with having had some great principles and, you know, we were this and we were that. I don't know about all that, but, you know, they came up short, and that keeps a band romantic in a way, and you can, and cool and hip, and I think that has benefited them certainly. So who's to say? They might have had a platinum record or a top 10 hit, but I don't, that might have, you know, sort of dismantled the legend a little bit too.
Right. Yeah. You know, they were so influential to so many bands that you know, that became bigger than they were. But I was reminded of this story that my ex-girlfriend Angie was the writer, music editor for the Weekly in Chapel Hill where we lived. And she interviewed him in 2002, and this quote popped into my head yesterday, and I was able to find it. So she interviewed Paul in 02, and he said, "The greatest thing we ever did when Chris was in the band was that we actually wallpapered one dressing room that was full of priceless graffiti. It had James Brown and Wilson Pickett and everybody who had ever played there. We ordered wallpaper, and we wallpapered it. We got some painter dude to bring it in, and we wallpapered the thing, and it was Warhol-esque. It was the most pro-destructive thing we could ever do." And she asks, "Do you look back and say, I was a dick?" And his answer was, "No, I look back and I can say I would still do that." but I didn't have three other guys to help me. And then she asked, you might have started a whole bunch of kids thinking that they had to get wasted to play. And he says, yeah, but the thing that those people miss is that the replacements wallpaper the dressing room.
Well, the upshot is that I think they did that more than once. You know, I think they painted once and wallpapered once.
So none of those bands who they influenced can claim anything like that.
Yeah, exactly.
Right?
My favorite story, quick aside. Peter Jesperson was telling me one time, the first time the replacements went to L.A., they were playing and the band was sleeping it off one morning after a gig at the Tropicana, and Peter, who had never been to California, thought, well, I'll take the van out and I'll drive to Beverly Hills. You know, boy from the Midwest, I'm going to go see Beverly Hills. As many of you know, Chris is an artist, did great caricatures and could do like comic characters perfectly. So Peter's driving through... Driving through Beverly Hills, and he notices people are giving him really, really dirty looks time after time, and he's like, well, you know, I realize I'm in a ratty rock and roll van, but, you know, is this that bad? He's just like, God, people are really looking down. And he gets back to the Tropicana, walks around the side of the van. He sees that Chris has drawn a perfect Fred Flintstone, aroused, with a bubble that says, do me, Wilma. So, and Chris had, of course, done this unbeknownst to Peter as he was driving around Rodeo Drive. So, anyway, so Chris was, you know, their mayhem and their destruction or their, you know, offensiveness could sometimes be very clever.
Oh, they were geniuses. Like they were the creativeness of their assholery was so top shelf. Like I don't know of anyone of any band that can equal the things that they did.
Practice makes perfect.
Right? Yeah. It's like G.G. Allen and the Murder Junkies did some crazy stuff, but they never papered a wallpapered a dressing room. Right?
True.
But I think the reason we're still talking about the Replacements all these years later is because of the music. You know, they had such great songs, such great albums that I think that's going to last forever, and that's ultimately why we still care.
I also think it's part of what they did performing. As I look out the crowd, I imagine there's a fair number of you who saw them play, you know, in their heyday, and as well as the reunion.
Did you?
I saw them twice. I saw them opening for Petty in Phoenix, and I saw them on the last tour. They were actually just sort of okay. They weren't trying to be super jerks at the Petty
right.
show. But, you know, one of the things that came across in the book over and over as I talked to people about seeing the Replacements or the times they saw the Replacements were just these little things that Paul did or that the band did. You know, somebody was talking about it the other night, I think it was at the Ritz or wherever it was, him just taking a helium balloon, sucking on helium and singing Born in the USA in a high-pitched voice. You know, he always, and Slim Dunlop talked about it in the book, he said, you know, Paul always threw one little wrinkle into every show that the people who were there would take away and remember and talk about for 30 years. And so I think a lot of times they're credited as, oh, you know, they didn't play great shows consistently or whatever, but I think they always, certainly Paul did, had a sense of leaving people with these moments that would be remembered. I mean, he said it, he told me, you know, the very first few months that the Replacements were playing just opening gigs at the Longhorn, he said, my goal was the next day, the people who saw the show didn't say, oh, did you hear the Replacements? It was, did you see the Replacements? So he was aware, I think, from the outset of creating this idea. And, you know, it's funny, the very first interview the band did just a couple months after forming, or after they'd met Peter Jesperson, so they'd played maybe five gigs, you know, and it was their first interview. Peter basically got him an interview with this local weekly, and they asked Paul what his goal was. This, bear in mind, this is July of 1980, and he said, well, we'd like to be famous without being professional, sort of like a big cult. And that's kind of the, you know, that's sort of what happened to them, and he had basically predicted that, and I think he sort of stage managed that in some ways, too.
Now, how far into the book were you when they announced that they were getting back together?
I had written most of a first draft, with the exception of the epilogue, so it was kind of to the end of the book, although there was, you know, still work to be done. And yeah, and as with most things, it was on, it was off, they weren't going to do it. I had heard they weren't going to do it directly from the manager, and then of course people at Riot Fest said they were going to do it, so I was, you know, I was well through it. And that was part of another additional delay on the book, as we just decided kind of have to see how this plays out, you know. Maybe they kill each other on stage. I don't know, you know. So we had to kind of see what happened. And fortunately, they just sort of petered out or came to an abrupt pause or stop last summer. And so into that void comes the book. So pretty good timing on my part, which was unplanned.
Right. What do you think the future holds for the replacements?
Is Ben Tommy's manager here? Somewhere? He could probably say better.
Put him on the spot.
Oh, there he is. I see him. He's hiding now.
Okay, we will not pursue this.
My feeling is, as it was when I started the book, there had been some sort of talk about them reuniting as early as 2008. And my feeling was, is what Paul and Tommy have, and I sort of came to come in between them at various points. You know, one of them would ask me, well, what's he been saying or what's he doing? You know, it's sort of a strange position to find yourself as intermediary, but I think a lot of people end up becoming intermediaries in that relationship. And I always thought the fact that they have this, you know, Paul described it to me, I don't think he's ever told Tommy, he's like, I have something with him that I don't have with any other human being, including anybody I've been married to. That we've seen things and done things and had the highs and the lows and the experiences that we've shared, you know, since Tommy's 12 years old. So I think he has a kind of relationship, whether he wants to acknowledge it to himself or to Tommy or to anyone other than me, that is very powerful. And I always thought that was the thing that would bring them together. And it was kind of midwifed by the fact that Slim got sick and fell ill. And I think they finally felt like, here's at least a cause. We could do something good for the first time. And that sort of prompted the reunion. And it forced them to sort of be together and see if they could react. But I also think it's very hard to maintain and revive a band 25 years later in any kind of real, meaningful way. Make records, tour, kind of continue on, especially when you've been apart that long. But my hope is, as I say in the book, I hope their story continues past these pages. And I think there's a chance, always a chance, that because everything they do is kind of spur of the moment, that there's more to the story. I hope there is, because I don't know how many of you saw the reunion shows, but with the exception of maybe one or two shows, I thought they were amazing. And it was nice, I think, for a lot of people like Michael Hill, and I don't know if Russ and Gary saw it, to be out there and to see, like, that many thousands and thousands of people going crazy for them, the way everybody thought they should and wanted them to back in the day. Yeah.
We got to open for them. Superchunk opened for them, which
their
last U.S. show in Philadelphia, and they were awesome. And I was really pleased with how many younger people there were there. You know, because it was a whole generation that hadn't seen them.
I think there was a point in the '90s where the Replacements' influence, you know, and I've said this before, I don't think any one band sort of picked up the Replacements' whole sound wholesale, but you see a lot of bands taking pieces of their sound or pieces of their catalog. I mean, you could look at what the success Green Day had and say, okay, they're mining the sort of melodic punk pop punk sensibilities of Sorry Ma or a little bit of Stink. You can look at a band like the Goo Goo Dolls and the success they had immediately after Johnny Resnick worked with Paul, and say, like, they took the adult contemporary sort of romantic side of Paul and made these big power ballads and had success. You look like a band like Wilco. I mean, Jeff Tweedy, it didn't end up in the book. He talked about how he learned to write songs after seeing Paul Westerberg. So I think their influence kind of isn't in one way in one band, but in little ways in a lot of bands. And I think there's a new generation now that are kind of rediscovering them. You know, Beach Slang, this band that is kind of in debt to the Replacements. They're going to be performing Please to Meet Me in its entirety later this summer. So, you know, I think it's coming around again, and there's enough distance now that they're kind of seen as legends. As I say, they sort of went from, they became legends without ever becoming stars.
It's true. Before we take any questions, I wanted to...
Yeah, we'll take a few questions and then I'll sign books and whatever.
I wanted to just read this quote, which I think kind of sums up the Replacements. This is Paul talking. I think we happen to coincidentally like all the funky quirks of the classic rock bands, the Who, the Stones, the Ramones, to a certain extent. We didn't have the things that made those bands huge. We had the thing that made them infamous, decadent, and perhaps great.
Yeah.
I think that's a great...
And that's a quote from an interview Ira Robbins did in...
Oh, it is. The great Ira Robbins.
Who generously gave his long interview he did with Paul.
Yes.
And I'm sure there's many people, other people I have to thank, but Ira was in my sight line, so...
Okay. So do we want some Q&A? Some questions?
Yeah, if you guys want to call on some people, I'll try to get on mic.
Sure. If anybody has any... Yes, sir, you.
over there.
I can repeat it if you want.
Yeah, I think that might work better.
Yeah, go ahead. Just tell me. I can hear you.
I'm just wondering if you learned anything about their musical process, whether it was writing, recording, that may surprise you or unexpected.
Yeah, he was asking if I learned anything about their musical process, writing or recording, that surprised me. Well, Paul was very impatient with the process of making studio recordings, certainly the way they were being done in the 80s. The thing that surprised me, actually, in talking to Russ and Gary and Tommy in particular, was there was a point where generally the first 5-6 years of the band, Paul would write songs or sketches of songs, skeletons of songs, and bring them to the band, and they would kind of finish them off. By the time they were really on the road through Pleased to Meet Me, and they were all married or getting married by this point, they hung out less and rehearsed less in downtime, and Paul got a 4-track machine and a drum machine. 4-track recorder and a drum machine. And Tommy, in a way, talked about how that fundamentally altered not just the songs, but the dynamic of the band. It, I think, further alienated Chris because he was no longer part of the creative process. And it made it very difficult. Paul basically has what they call demoitis, I think, in that he hears his demos and the sort of rigid drum beat of a drum machine, and kind of that's how he gets it fixed in his head, because he is such a person of the immediate. The first time he hears something is kind of going to always be the best in his mind. And The Replacements live, you know, when you get the four of them in the room, it's never going to sound like a drum machine. I think that's partly why Paul has made all his records himself in his basement for the last 15 years, you know, too, because the demos are the records, essentially. So that was something that surprised me, that, you know, going into Don't Tell a Soul, and by the time they make All Shook Down, which was really started as a demos project, you know, Paul, it's weird for a guy who's so much about the spirit of the moment and sort of, you know, these flashpoints in the studio, that he loves his shitty 4-track demos so much. But that's kind of, that was a thing that altered a lot for them, you know, and I think it affected a lot of relationships, the creative relationship in the band at that point, too. Yes, sir, Mr. Robbins.
Did you have any trouble selling this book to a publisher? Out the numbers back up the chart?
I did and I didn't. There was a number of people who were very interested. Publishers at good-sized publishing houses or imprints, but I had some delay from the point that Paul and Tommy and Peter and all the main people agreed to do the book till I had the proposal and sold it. The economy crashed, and a lot of those publishing houses sort of kind of went by the wayside. So there was still a couple suitors, and I got I would think a decent advance. If you want to know, I'll tell you that later. For
$500,000.
For a first-time author, but DiCapo really stepped up, and they were the ones, you know, interested from the first, Ben Schaefer, and I really have to credit them. I did tell him this would take 2 years, and after year three and year four and year five, you know, they had every right to say, go away, and where's our money? But they stuck with it, and you know, the book has done very well, and it's been received well, and the day it actually came out, DiCapo got bought by Hachette, which is the biggest, or one of the biggest publishers, so I'm going to take credit for that.
Yeah.
It wasn't difficult. I think it would be easier now. You know, it would have been easier after the reunion if I'd have sold it, because they just raised their profile so much, and I think the people who are Replacements fans have kind of risen to those executive positions in a way, so.
Blue shirt.
Can you talk about, because Chris did speak to you for the book, can you talk about writing the book without Chris? And also, who was Chris chummy with in the band? There's a lot of Paul and Tommy.
Sure.
Chris,
he was asking about Chris's involvement in the book. Chris wasn't involved directly. I approached him. I had done some interviews with him prior to the book starting for some stuff for Spin. I approached him with it. Chris, in a lot of ways, he's a very, those some of you may or may not know, he's a very successful artist, contemporary artist, and is well-known in that world at an incredible level. I mean, he sells his pieces for vast sums, and he's, you know, he's not Chris Mars from The Replacements, he's Chris Mars the artist. So I think in many ways he's kind of moved on from that. As Paul put it in the book, he said, you know, Chris puts the band on a level as his paper route as a kid. You know, he had a paper route, and then he was in a band, and then he became a very successful artist, which is what he always wanted to do. But Chris was, you know, early on, Paul and Chris were very close because they grew up in the same neighborhood. Paul was classmates with Chris's older brother, and Paul always had his eye on Chris. The first time he really saw Chris playing, he was playing, they were at his house, the house of a neighbor, this guy Kevin Patrick, who ended up playing in some Prince-related bands. And Chris sat down at this guy's drum kit, and it was a very nice new drum kit, and was like playing the rims and everything. And the guy's like, get off my drum kit. So I think immediately Paul's like, I like that guy, you know. He was, so early on they were very chummy, because you have to remember Bob was, you know, even though Bob and Paul were the drive of the band early on, I think the Stinsons were maybe a little different social class too than Chris and Paul, so they were more connected initially. And then later Slim came into the band, and Slim was somebody who kind of talked to everybody individually. He was a psychologist and offered counsel and many other things, so he was close to Chris. But you know, Chris's move away from the band was probably inevitable, you know, as it got more chaotic and he got less interested in that and was able to be less creative. So, but in terms of making him a character in the book, I thought it was totally essential, and so I spent a lot of time. He didn't make it easy, but I still had to do it. And, you know, I didn't have access to Bob, obviously, because he had passed in 95. I had access to some interviews, the same as I did with Chris. And so, you know, you talk to people and you flesh them out and you make them three-dimensional. I didn't want it to be exclusively the Tommy and Paul story, although it does become that, because that kind of was the reality after a certain point. But, I mean, early on, when you read about their childhoods, I sort of give it all equal weight. And you know, I made a real effort to do that.
Sir.
Great book, won it twice.
Oh, thank you. If anybody else wants to buy the book twice, you're allowed to do that.
The Mystery Crew was playing Camden in 85, doing really well. Why did the replacements, why did they not make the transition with the UK crowd?
Well, none of the records were out until after Tim had come out, or before, right around Tim came out, this Boink EP, which was kind of a thing. So none of their records were out. They weren't really known. Quite frankly, Paul, I don't think liked Europe. I mean, there's a scene in the book where the band is like so desperate for ice and matches and the things you can't get in England.
It's still that way.
Yeah. And there's a funny, they had this British road manager, Andy Proudfoot, who says, you know, we were in Perugia, which is this beautiful ancient Etruscan city and has all this great Roman history, and they're just walking, he's walking through it, and the rest of the band is so mad because there isn't a Denny's there, you know, late at night. And so they went back in 87, and that record was set up really well. They were on the cover of the Melody Maker, I believe, which Paul always thought Russ somehow got that done under the table, but I don't think that's true. But anyway... And then they didn't go back until the last tour. So, and it's funny because you see bands like, I mean, Sugar eventually became more successful, but bands like the Pixies, Dinosaur Jr., you know, bands, American bands that became very successful, even Mudhoney over there, the Replacements kind of missed out on that. And really by the time they were, you know, that 89 era and 90 where those bands were really succeeding in Europe, the Replacements didn't sound like they did in 85 or 87. So, you know, they just, a lot of it was down to the fact that, and Paul hasn't gone back there a whole lot either. I was surprised the Replacements did on the reunion, but he likes Minnesota and where he lives and America somewhat, but Europe is not his speed. Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry, I'll go there. The one the question was, does Paul have a favorite solo album? The one that was sort of, orphaned by Capitol, Suicane Gratification, because that was a kind of a piano record and a different kind of record. I talked to Don Was about the making of that. It, originally, I think that was more of a concept record. It was tied together, and then Paul, as is his want, he sort of changed things and obscured things and knocked it off. But he always says that's the record that people will rediscover at some point. But, you know, I've heard him say that, but... him, that answer could change too. Any questions? Yes.
Purple shirt.
I've had a couple of friends who are big fans say, I'm kind of afraid to read the book because what if they're dicks? I just wanted to get your take on the idea of separating an artist and their art from, you know, having a beer with them.
Yeah, he's saying there's been some reaction among people, fans of the band, who were afraid of reading the book. First of all, it's not going to hurt you. It's going to be okay. But I understand that, you know, the Replacements have been so romanticized Over the years, and people hold them dear to their hearts. As I said, I'm not a casual Replacements fan. I don't think there is such a thing as a casual Replacements fan. Maybe there's a few. And so you don't want your heroes to, you don't really want to see their ugly side, or you don't want the truth to be revealed that there wasn't some grand conspiracy necessarily to keep them from success, that it was maybe their own doing and their own limitations. I get that, but at the same time, as a reader, as somebody who's interested in, you know, I'd rather, in that case here, the fact than the legend. I think at the end of the day, I'm sure they hurt some people professionally and harm some people, but the people they harm the most with their behavior, the things they did with them, were themselves, you know, in that moment. So maybe Russ and Gary and Michael would disagree, I've heard that complaint, but I mean, I think the book is entertaining, and at least you get a sense of why that is, or what the behavior is, and they were dicks. But if you look at it in terms of where they were coming from and what their history was and what their personal history was and the things they dealt with, you know, from mental health issues to alcoholism to abuse, it's like, okay, well, at least I get this now, some of this behavior, even if some of it didn't make sense, like burning their per diems. But you want to come?
I thought you did.
Right.
I remember when I first
sure.
that when I was 95 or 94, being really devastated.
Right. He's asking about the 1993 spin article on Bob Stinson that Charles Aaron wrote, who's a friend, and I didn't, you know, that was one of the things that I think has lingered with Paul, and it was kind of repeated in Michael Ozerod's book. And the story could very well be true in terms of the specific incident. What I took exception to and tried to sort of unpack was that it didn't happen quite like that. It wasn't drink or get off my stage and he was fired the next day. There was a whole year of stuff. And in general, to the bigger point about Bob and why I spend so much time on Bob and his life early on, is to understand that his problems were so much bigger than the Replacements, so much bigger than anything Paul Westerberg ever did or anything that happened to the band, that those were things that he had to deal with, you know, going all the way back to his childhood. And so that was the only thing that I really wanted to dispel, that, you know, Bob Stinson's life didn't sort of begin and end with the Replacements. He would live for another 10 years after he was out of the band. And so, you know, that there are those moments where I'd kind of clarify things that are in the kind of popular conception. But in general, talking about Bob and why I made him so important was to understand that nobody's at fault for what happened to Bob, except for, you know, the people who really victimized him earlier on. Couple more, and I think we probably should wrap. Yes, you, sir.
Yeah. Is there any plan, or would you be interested in any kind of like adaptation of this to some kind of like a cinematic?
What the question was, would I be interested in any cinematic adaptation? If there's money involved.
It's all about money for
it's
you.
It's all about. No, I mean, I think, I don't know about cinema. There are people who are interested in that, but that's a Hollywood thing, and you never know how much that's serious. If it's going to be a story where, like, I don't, you know, a lot of times, like this Miles Davis movie, they always put a journalist in there so they can tell the story. Now, if they have a journalist and they allow me to do the casting, pick who plays me.
I think you should play yourself.
Well, somebody better looking, hopefully. But yeah, no, I'd be interested in that. But, you know, it's a story that functions on so many levels, and it might be a little hard to unpack, but... yeah, I'll, if anybody's interested. Yes, sir.
Sir.
How's Slim?
Slim is doing okay. He is surrounded by a really amazing family. His wife has basically devoted her life to taking care of him. Slim had suffered a pretty massive stroke about 4 years ago, and you know, I go see him every time there, and he's communicative in his own way, but. Yeah, so you know, it's not the best scenario or situation, but he's trying to get better, and he's very fortunate that, you know, people come and play music for him. Paul lives down the street, comes and visits him, so it's making the best of an unfortunate situation. So, yes, sir.
You mentioned Mike Lazarus. I was curious how our big your like your thinking about the book's idea or publishers, how that book.
Well, he was asking, how did Michael Ozrod's Our Band Could Be Your Life, which was a very successful book and really kind of the first, I think, in a way to tackle that era historically, you know, American indie, DIY, whatever you want to call it.
And am I correct that Chris was the only member to speak
Chris
for that
was
one,
the only right? one, because no. Chris sort of said his piece, I think, in that. They're such contrarians. No, it was very important, I think, just to show Ozrod's book, to show that, like, this era of bands and this period of music is as valid as the Beatles and the Stones and anything else, that you can approach it historically and seriously and tell a story that's compelling. The funny thing with Michael Ozrod's book is because, you know, so many of those bands, it's funny to have a book, to me, other than era. You look at a band like Husker Du or the Minutemen, so DIY, so do it. So the Replacements were the least DIY band. They couldn't get to their own gigs.
Yeah.
That's the baseline.
Yeah.
You know, they literally couldn't drive to their own gigs. So I think they kind of, in a weird way, get lumped into that. And of course, this book, my book, sort of dispels that,
sure
they wanted somebody to haul their gear from the first day. So maybe just one more. Anybody? No?
Want to go sign some books?
I will. I do want to thank the Strand. This is a really incredible event. It's great to be in this room. I want to thank my dear friend Jon Wurster for doing this. He came all the way from North Carolina to do this.
On a bike.
And if I can, Russ, Gary, Michael, please just stand up. These guys, Michael Hill, please stand up. That's Russ. Over there, that's Michael Hill. That's Russ in the white shirt. Gary Habib over there. There was a New Yorker piece about the book and about the band, and it said, you know, the Replacements, they didn't make maybe good spouses or good clients, they make for a good story. So I had the easy part, they had the hard part. So I have to thank them, I'm eternally grateful. So yeah, I will be over here signing, and folks who know me, I will see you afterwards.
Thank you,
thank
everybody.
Thank you so much.
Thank both of you so much.